Anyways, you got me on like a crazy rabbit trail, and my mind is like going nuts right now. It is like fireworks here. Focus. Okay, here we go. Back on task. All right, so tonight I want to start by asking us three questions. Now, on the first question, I need you to answer me, okay? I need you to answer me. Why? Because it's going to get awkward if you don't answer me. And then the second question is a yes or a no answer. And I don't need you to vocalize yes or no. I want you to just raise a hand. If your answer is yes, you will then raise a hand. And then on the third question, I don't need any answers. I want you to think about it. I want it to sit. I want it to be like a chicken and Italian dressing and just marinade in your mind, all right? Because everybody knows a good steak, a good piece of chicken needs a good marinade. And so this question is going to marinate in your mind this evening. So the first question is this, and why I sound like I'm a DJ on the radio, I have no idea. So our first question is this. What? That was two words all in one. What do you think is the main reason we come to church? What do you think is the main reason we come to church? Tony, to give him praises, okay. Mary, to what? To be with God, yes. Zach Mayo, community, okay. Any others? Miranda, to get closer to God. These are all, yes, because he told us to. I'll give you that one. Anybody else? Missing any hands? The lights are right in my eyes. All of these are pretty good answers. All of these, if you boil them down, all of these answers, and even answers not answered here, if you boil these answers down, we come to church to have an encounter with God. We come to church to experience something from God. Oh, I've been forgetting for a long time, and I saw you typing over here, of which made me think about it. If you got your phones, tablets, pen, paper, pencil, any writing utensil, pull them out and take notes. Because as I said before quarantine and totally forgot until just now, a note taker is a... I'm about to slap you in your face, Zach Mayo. World changer, correct. A note taker is a world changer. So yes, a note taker is a world changer. Yes, so I hate you so much. Shut up, adults. Anyway, so the first question, if you're taking notes, what is the main reason we come to church? My answer is, if you boil it all down, it comes to having some type of encounter, some type of experience with God. And that is so important. That is so important because it doesn't matter if it's a person's first time in church or their 10,100,000th to infinity and beyond time in church. Most of us are coming at some point, if not every time, to get something from God. Now, it might be something as big as, God, my right arm fell off. Jesus, grow my arm back. There it is. Or it might be something as, God, my puppy dog's sick. Heal my puppy dog, Jesus. Or it could be just, God, I want more of you. God, I need more of you. So, I'm going to ask this. Who in here right now, not last week, but right now would say, I need something from God right now? It doesn't matter if it's small or if it's big, but raise your hand and of would say, I need something from God right now. Anybody? We got one, two, three, four, five, six, seven. I'm going to say pretty much everybody in this room right now has their hand up, which leads me to my third question right here. Why is it then that we don't have encounters with God every week. Let it marinate. Like the chicken in the Italian dressing, let it marinate. Soak it in. Why don't we have... Caitlin's like, oh my God, he's weird. If you just figured that out, good grief, girl. Anyways. Why don't we have encounters with God every week? If we need something from God, then how come every time we open our Bibles and we pray, we don't have encounters with God? This is why, I think. One of the main reasons we don't have encounters with God every time you come to church, every time you open up a Bible, every time you pray, is because you are not expecting an encounter with God. It's because we, every time, are not expecting an encounter with God. Because for a lot of us, we just think, okay, I'm going to go to a church. Song starts, you know what, I really don't like this song that much. You know what, I'm not a big fan of this song. I mean, I guess I'll raise my hand. You know, Pastor Doss or Pastor Scotty, they're really not preaching on the things of that I'm going through right now, so I really can't even go to the altar. I really can't seek God right now because what they're talking about, it's really not what I'm going through right now. That is the voice of a person who is not expecting God to do anything. But the voice of a person of who is expecting God, oh no, the actions of a person that is expecting God is looking for God even in the slightest bit. A person that is expecting God is, oh, you know what? I love this song, but you know what? I have heard Graves Into Garden 20,000 times, but God, you turn graves into gardens. You seek those moments of where, you know what? There's the slightest bit of God's presence, and so I'm going to enter in as deep and as much as I can because, God, I need something out of you right now, and so I'm going to look for it. I'm going to look for those moments. God, the pastor may not even be preaching on the things of that I'm going through right now, but God, I just want more of you. God, I need a breakthrough. God, I need something to happen, so I'm going to come to the altar anyways. Whoa, Scotty. Answer an altar call that the pastor didn't even preach about? Yeah. There was one time I was needing something out of God so bad. A wife. And Pastor Greg obviously doesn't preach about
having a wife.
And so I don't even know what Pastor Greg was preaching on. But guess what? I was seeking a wife also. But I was seeking God. I was praying and I was fasting. And I said, God, I'm expecting you to do something. And so, again, I don't even know what Pastor Greg was preaching on. But I go to the altar and I'm seeking after God. And I have a movement of God inside of me. Why? Because I was expecting a movement of God. Because I was expecting God to do something in my life. And guess what? My wife's back there. So, I was expecting it. I was expecting God to do something. And so it pushed me just a little bit more. It made me go just a little bit farther. Because when we're expecting God, we are looking until there it is. But if we're just getting our church card stamped, getting our I read and prayed card stamped, we aren't expecting anything. We're just going through those motions. See, we just got done talking about the series, My God. and even for people of who God hasn't yet become their God, but they're in the process of making that turn, they're still expecting. They're expecting God to do things. And so they're seeking him. They're being pushed farther. Why? Not because anybody is making them, but because they want to be in God's presence. They want to have an experience of with God, and so they're seeking it because they want to. That's so important, of that we want to do these things. And so those of who have an expectation, those that are expecting God, things are more likely to happen. Camp is a perfect example of this. Camp is a perfect example of this because at camp, we go to camp thinking what? God's going to move. I'm going to get slain of in the spirit. The speaker is going to go, the Spirit of God compels you. Ah! And you're going to go, ah! You expect it. You expect God to move. And so what happens? God moves. God moves in those moments. So why don't we expect God to move up here? Why don't I expect God to move in my life at home? I can't answer that. I can't answer that because for each person, that's a different answer. But I can say this, for those that will look and expect God to move, you will see those things happen more. The Bible is full of these stories. Mark chapter 10. I told this story already up here, but it's a phenomenal story. Jesus is coming to Jericho. Blind Bartimaeus sitting down with his government assigned jacket that says, I'm a blind man and I can beg wherever I want to and there's nothing you can do about it. Sitting on his corner, cup in hand, alms, alms, alms is money. And so he's waiting, asking for people to give him money. And what does he do? Because he can't see, he hears. He hears everybody talking about how Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming to a town. Have you heard what Jesus has done? Have you heard of all of the things Jesus has done? So Bartimaeus sits up and he gets ready. And when the crowd gets big, when the crowd starts to pass by him, he says, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Everybody, shut up. Shut up. You're interrupting him. You're getting in his way. What does he do? He gets louder. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus stops and he says, bring him here. And they say, cheer up. He's calling on you. First of all, you just told him to shut up and now saying, cheer up. Makes no sense. But he jumps up and he throws his jacket off that says, I'm a blind man. Of that says, my life has sucked since the day I was born. I have been poor and I will always be poor. But he throws it off and he walks to Jesus. Why? Because he was expecting something to happen. Because he was expecting Jesus to do something in his life. And so then Bartimaeus stands in front of Jesus and Jesus says, what do you want from me? The sarcastic person in me would say, well, Jesus, I would like a number five with fries and a Coke, please. But he said, Lord, I want to see. I want to see. So Jesus just, and he sees. Why? because he was expecting that Jesus could do something. And so he called out and he reached for it as much as he could. Mark 5. Jesus just gets into another town. A teacher runs up to him. "Master, master, my daughter is deathly sick. She is on her deathbed. Please come and heal her. Please come and touch her because she is about to die." And so Jesus, with a crowd of people around him, they begin walking to this person's house. And then suddenly, while they're walking, Jesus stops and says, "Hold up, who touched me?" Peter says, "Well, master, there's a lot of people pressing in against us. A lot of people touched you." Jesus says, No. "I felt power come out of me. Who touched me?" Time out. Come in, guys. Lean in a little bit on me here. Thank you. Jesus didn't even try to heal a person, but he said, "I felt power come out of me." What? And so Jesus turns around. Okay, everybody, back up again. And so Jesus turns around and he says, "Who did this? Who touched me?" And this woman on the ground slowly stands up and says, "I touched you. I touched you." See, this woman had an issue of blood for 12 years. She had been bleeding for 12 years. She started off as a very wealthy person, but spent all of her money, all of her income on trying to fix this problem, but nothing could do it. But she heard about Jesus. And she said, "I've heard everything he's done. I've heard everything he's done. I'm going to go to a him." And so what does she do? She doesn't even ask him to heal her. She knows, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, the hem, that. If I can touch the hem of his garment, I'll be healed. So what does she do? She's fighting that crowd. Excuse me. And she sees Jesus and she just reaches and barely touches it. And immediately, she was healed. As this person was talking, a servant of the teacher runs up and says, "My Lord, your daughter is dead. Don't even bother with the master, for she's dead." Jesus says, "You shut up. Take me to her." So that they go in and everybody's crying. Everybody's like, "She's gone. She's gone." Jesus says, "Send all of these people out. For this girl isn't dead. She's just sleeping." So everybody goes out. Jesus takes her by the hand and says, "Girl, wake up." And she immediately came back to life again. Now, in both instances in this story, they were expecting Jesus to do something. They were so in need of Jesus to do something that one even said, "If I touch his shirt, I'll be touched. If I can just touch his shirt, I will be changed." Another said, "Master, just come and do something. Just come and do something. I've heard so much about you. I know that you can do something." They were expecting There was an expectancy inside of them of that said, he can do something. He's gonna do something. I don't know what, but he's gonna do something. So again, it doesn't matter how big or how small anything is, but if we have an expectancy, if we'll come to church expecting to have an encounter with God, if we will read our Bible and pray expecting, something will happen. I want to do something tonight. I want all of us to stand up really fast. I'm not done preaching yet, but there's a song that came out a couple of months ago. And there's something about this song. And I like it. And I don't know why I like it, but I like it. But I think this song teaches us about expectancy. This song teaches us about coming in with expectations. So this is what I want us to do this evening. This is a very simple song. Kind of a long song, but it's a simple song. The words aren't up on the screen, but it's very simple. Listen to this song. Listen to what the song is telling us. And I'll talk after the song. I like how the song, it starts off so simple and so soft. But it's almost as if, as the people begin to really think about, what would I do? Emma, start that over and have it soft, please. But it's almost as if they started to think, how would I act? How would I praise if Jesus was right there? I love how the worship people just fell on the ground, streaming tears, giving God the praise and the honor of that God deserved. Because they started to think, what would I do? So my question this evening is, what would you do if you knew that at the end of this, what I'm expecting, what I'm needing is going to happen? How would you pray? How would you pray if God, during this moment of prayer, what I'm expecting to happen is going to happen? What if God, by the time I stand up from this altar, what I'm expecting, what I'm needing to happen is going to happen? God, after I put my Bible down or from studying of what your word says, what I'm expecting, what I'm needing is going to happen. I had an adult tell us one time, and it stuck in my mind ever since. Expectancy is the breeding ground for the supernatural. If we'll expect God to do something, if we'll come to church expecting God to do something, if we'll open our Bibles, if we'll pray expecting God to do something, how would that change? How would that change how we act? How would that change how we see a church service? How we see our time reading of and praying? I'm not trying to get like some like superficial hype talking about camp up here one night, but I'm talking about daily. I'm talking about every Wednesday night up here, every Sunday downstairs. If we'll come to church, if we'll read our Bibles and pray, expecting for a move of God in our lives. Like Bartimaeus, I'm getting up, throwing off everything of that has said one thing about me, coming to God expecting another. God, even if I can touch just a bit of your garment, I'll be changed. God, if I can have just a taste of your presence, just a taste of your Holy Spirit, what I need is going to happen. So God, I'm expecting that. So this evening, I don't know what everybody's going through. I don't know what you need out of God. But almost every hand in this room said, I need something from God. It might be something huge, it might be something small, but whatever you need this evening, I'm gonna turn this music back up and we're just gonna spend time with God. Because if we expect God to move, there's a better chance of us to have that encounter. Because we're looking for it. We're looking for that encounter. So Jesus, this evening, God, we come to you and we just ask of in these next few moments of that your Holy Spirit be in this place. God, of what we need out of you, God, we would begin to see those things happen. So Jesus, tonight, move in this place. Move in our hearts, Jesus. Move in our lives and our spirits. This evening, if you want to come to the altar, this altar is open for you. If you want to get up in a corner and pray some, pray there. But let's spend some time expecting God to move in our lives tonight. The king is in the room. Your healer's in the room. Your savior's in the room. Your provider's in the room. Your redeemer's in the room. Your champion's in the room. He's in this room.